Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the United States. Hope you guys are doing all right. I've been busy. I've been very busy doing the things of the Lord. I've been seeking the Lord also, and you know, I'm just waiting to hear more from the Lord. But I just wanted to come on here and talk to you guys. I've so many things that the Lord is sharing with me. You know, first off, I would just like to say, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of His people. Now, you have not because you ask not. And then you ask amiss to consume it on your own lust. Brothers and sisters, God wants to do so many things with you. And I have so many different messages from the Lord. The Lord's been dumping on me. Let me just say this. People talk about watchmen on the wall. People being a watchman on the wall. But you know what? What do watchmen do when they're on the wall? They declare that, hey, you know, the enemy's coming, or in our case too, the king is returning. You know, the king is on his way back. That's what most of the people are talking about, being watchmen, not watching that about, you know, the enemy coming and sin and all that, but watchmen about the, hey, here comes the king. He's coming back from a long journey, as Jesus said that he would go on a long journey in a parable, and he would come back. And he says, when the Son of Man returns, would he find any faith on earth? But you know what, brothers and sisters, the Lord was just, you know, revealing to me just a few minutes ago that when the watchman would cry, hey, in this case, the king is coming back. Hey, I can see the king. He's topping the hill. He's coming with his entourage. Then all the people are supposed to come up on the wall. When something's going down, you don't need the watchman anymore. The watchmen are out there when everybody's asleep, when it's night. When nothing is happening, you know, or if everybody's working and doing something else, you got a, you know, watchman along the wall, spaced out while the other people are working, or the other people are sleeping or doing something else. But once the watchman had been crying out, everyone, every able-bodied person is supposed to get to the wall. Brothers and sisters, I was just seeing up on the wall just a little while ago. You know, I was praying and I saw that wall. You know, I was up on the wall, brothers and sisters, and then I heard, you know, the American Star Spangled Banner. And brothers and sisters, that song, brothers and sisters, is written by Francis Scott Key. He was a lawyer who was trying to negotiate peace in the Baltimore Harbor. There, I was at Fort McHenry, and he was out on a British vessel, and he was kind of being held, you know, as a prisoner slash negotiator, you know, a hostage slash negotiator in that situation. And he was a lawyer, and he was watching that fort, which was held by the Americans. You know, the original flag from that battle is there in the Smithsonian Institute, in the American Museum at the Smithsonian Institute, in the mall in front of the American Capitol building. And I've seen it. I've been there before and saw it many years ago. But brothers and sisters, the whole thing of that, the song is, "Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed?" You know, at the twilight's last gleaming. You know, and so Francis Scott Key is asking, you know, in that Elizabethan English and that poetry, he's asking, "Is the American flag still standing? Because it's night." There's a battle going on, you know, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Well, brothers and sisters, in what I saw while I was praying just a little while ago, just a few minutes ago, the Lord's been showing me all kinds of stuff, and I need to make 100 videos. And just like to say, too, like from the song of these are the days of Elijah, at the end of that, they say there is no God like Jehovah, you know, the name of the Father, Yahweh. There is no God like Him. And that's the word of the Lord for the United States and for His church. For the church in the United States, there is no God like Yahuwah, like our Lord and like our God. There's nobody like Him, brothers and sisters. I want to tell you, I was on that rampart, and it was covered in snow. Those of you who have been watching my videos that a long time ago, even before they made that My Pet Goat 2, those of you, look it up, you know what I'm talking about. Long before that video, My Pet Goat 2, came out, I had a dream, and I made a video about it, about being in a church that was covered in snow, and it was America, and President Clinton was speaking. And all this stuff was going on in my dream. And that snow represents, you know, the United States churches in America is frozen. It's in a winter. It's in, you know, it's not active, you know, it's not alive, but frozen, suspended animation. Now, I made a video a couple years ago about that. Maybe you can find the link to it, put it on there, but I don't remember what I called it. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I was on that rampart, on the wall. I was a watchman on the wall, and I saw that I saw the guns, the cannons were all covered in snow. Everything was covered in snow. And there was no one else on the wall but me. It was totally covered in snow. Our brothers and sisters, and then I heard that Star Spangled Banner, you know, was that flag still standing? What's going on? Now the watchmen have been crying, you know, that America's going down the tubes, that America's dead, the church is falling away, the enemy's coming. And that's what I'm trying to tell you. The Lord showed me stuff, brothers and sisters, that I'm not at liberty, you know, from the Spirit of the Lord to reveal it. But I've already made videos about that. People have already been making videos about the destruction of America and all that. That the enemy is coming in and overrunning this country because there's no watchman. And when I say watchman, I mean the church, not just those people who are YouTube making videos. I'm talking about the church is called to be watchman. And then when the watchman cried, hey, you know, the church is falling, all of this, all of the true Christians, the prayer warriors, the warriors are supposed to get up on the wall with the watchman. Then we don't need watchmen when everybody's on alert. And the problem is people have been saying, hey, something's going down, you know, United States is about to be destroyed. The New World Order is rising. The Antichrist is coming to power. The end is at hand. And, you know, the Lord's going to rapture those who can pass under the shepherd's rod and be found without spot or blemish. That's a whole other message that the Lord gave me that I need to make about, too. I just wanted to throw it out there because it's in my mind right now. You know, passing under the shepherd's rod, that one, you know, that those who will be considered to be an offering to the Lord, that would be those sheep without spot or blemish that would pass underneath. Something else the Lord's been talking to me about the last 2 days. Anyway, brothers and sisters, where are you on the wall? Where are you in your prayer, your intercession? You're supposed to be a warrior for the Lord, your armor of God and all those things. Where are you? Where are you? The Lord needs you. Where are you? The Lord needs all of his people. You know, that's the message that I make. We can talk about asteroids coming. You can talk about ISIS. You can talk about the fact that, Saddleback, Brokeback Saddleback, Preacher with Chris Slime. You can talk about Joel Osteen and compromising and all those people wasting all their time worried about all what everybody else is doing. But we are called to do one thing, brothers and sisters, that's to keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ, to worship him individually. Our salvation is not corporate. Even though we, the corporate, the called out ones, the ecclesia, the church, the body of Christ, you know, are one in Christ. We are individually called to be saved, called to be servants of God, called to be warriors for the Lord. So what I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters, is get out there and pray. Get out there and proclaim the word. I mean, there's some people who have we all are called to be prayer warriors. We're all called to do the work of an evangelist, all those things. But of course, we different have primary roles. Some people are pastors. Some people, you know, are missionaries, all of those kind of things. Some people are business people. And then, you know, you do part-time, you buy Bibles and send them to the Philippines. You send them to Africa, whatever, to all of those different details. It doesn't matter. We're all called to serve the Lord. And brothers and sisters, that's, I've talked about this before. God needs you. God needs you. If America has, let's just say that 10% of the American church is really born again. 10%. So in America, I think it's, I think it's like 70% of people say they believe in Jesus and all this. Let's say that. So out of that, what is that? Let's just say there's 10 million real Christians in the United States. Just throw out a number, 10 million. 10 million real Christians would go win if every person would go out and evangelize and win. What would that be? How many people to the Lord? If you won 10 people, that'd be, what would that be? 100 million? If 10 million won 10 people each, that would be 100 million. So if you won, if each person won, whatever, multiply, whatever. I can't think about it right now. You know, that doesn't matter. You know, there's lots of people too who are sticklers for those little things, and that's awesome. But that has nothing to do with the price of peas in Kansas, as they say. You know, it's not about majoring in the minors. It's about, you know, bringing glory to God. doing his will, answering the call to get on the wall. Why do you keep waiting for somebody else to get on the wall? Why do you keep getting, you know what I mean? It's all cool and it's a great hobby to calculate your shoe size times the circumference of the earth, times the wind speed in Arizona, times the temperature at dawn in Jerusalem on a blood moon and all that to try to calculate when the rapture is going to happen, to try to calculate, you know, when the tribulation will begin and who's the Antichrist. That's all fun and games and it's all cute and it's all a great hobby. But what does it have to do with the fact that, you know, the day is far spent, the night is over, the summer's over, and we're not saved? Millions and millions or billions of people who are going to be left behind when the rapture happens. Billions of people are going to go to hell. You know, and even that is only secondary. Even people dying and going to hell is secondary to our personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we can't be a blessing unless we're blessed. You know, we can't tell somebody else about Jesus if we're not saved. You know, if we're not healed, as Jesus said, you know, physician, heal thyself. If you ain't right with God, you can't be worried about somebody else being right with God. And that is a whole other batch of morons running around. They ain't even saved themselves. They don't even have the gospel, and they're trying to tell somebody else, indoctrinate someone into their false gospel of Mormonism, Jehovah's Witnesses, Roman Catholicism, whatever the cult of, you know, whatever flavor of cult that you desire to talk about. Brothers and sisters, today is the day to get on that wall. Stop living in a fantasy land. Stop living in virtual reality. Stop vicariously living through others and get out there and do your part. Brothers and sisters, like I say, we all have our specialty. We all have our specialty. You need to get in prayer. You need to get in prayer and you need to wrestle with the Lord just like Jacob did. And you need to get in there and get in the ring with Jesus until you know that you know that you know that you know that you're saved. Romans 8:16, His Spirit will bear witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. And once you establish that, then you get in the ring and you wrestle with the Lord and you wrestle with the Lord and you wrestle with the Lord until He'll bless you. Like Jacob said, I'm not going to let go of you until you bless me. And God changed His name from Jacob to Israel. He who wrestles with God and man and overcomes. His name was changed from a supplanter, or a heel grabber, trying to take somebody else's place, his older brother Esau's place as the firstborn, you know, one with that double portion inheritance and all that. He supplanted Esau through trickery with his mom's plan for him to get the firstborn blessings. But then he wrestled with the Lord, and he had his name changed to he who wrestles with God and man and overcomes, and a prince of God. That's what you have to do. You have to wrestle with the Lord until the Lord blesses you so that you can be a blessing. You know, people talk about, as an example, let's just take the simplest one that people get confused on the easiest. Let's talk about finances. People say, oh, we don't want no prosperity gospel. You know, Lord wants us. The Bible says that we're supposed to help widows and orphans. The Bible says we're supposed to, you know, help the poor to literally, even though we give them the gospel, we're supposed to literally also feed them. Now, of course, the Lord can multiply what you've got, then feed the 5,000 and all that. But also in the natural, you can't feed the poor if you can't eat yourself. That's true with giving someone the gospel. If you don't have the gospel, if you don't know what it means to be saved, as Peter said, if you're not prepared to give a defense of the hope that lies within you, if you're not prepared to articulate what it means to be saved, well then, and you don't know you're saved and you don't have it even down in your own mind what it means to be saved, then you sure can't save somebody else and tell someone the gospel and lead someone else to salvation. You surely can't do the same thing with finances. If you don't have enough money to feed yourself, you surely can't give money to feed somebody else. The same thing is true with anything you take. You have to have been there, know that, and done that, and have the wisdom of the Lord before you can start telling anybody else. So let's put it in a succinct bullet. You know, let me see if I can get this right. You know, you can't you can't teach anybody beyond what you know. You know, in other words, a Baptist preacher who hasn't been baptized in the Holy Spirit, who has this false doctrine about how no one's supposed to be baptized in the Holy Spirit since the time of the apostles, or, you know, or getting saved is baptized in the Holy Spirit, when it's not, he can't get up there and do a sermon and preach and talk about speaking in tongues and what it's all about and all that, because he doesn't know any better. He doesn't have that revelation and that understanding. He's something he can't talk about. And so someone that's not saved, you can't give a revelation and give a testimony and explain about what it's like to be saved and all that if you've never been saved. And the same thing is true. You can't go out and you know, and feed people and do this, that, and the other, and all the things for God if you've never done it before. Just like business, you know? And that's the problem with lots of people. They take advice, you know, what they used to call it, well, let's say, use a nice word, jailhouse lawyers, you know? Someone that's not a lawyer, that's, you know, never been a lawyer, maybe they've been arrested, they've been to court, maybe they've been to jail. Next thing you know, they're a legal expert, you know? So we have to have those experiences. And those experiences, brothers and sisters, comes with our active participation in the kingdom of God. You need to get a hold of Jesus and have your own personal relationship with Jesus. That's what it means to be saved. To be a Christian means a follower of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, follow me. Anyone that doesn't take up your cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. He who puts his hand to the plow and turns back is not worthy of me. You need to follow Jesus Christ. Stop living in all this. A lot of people think being a Christian is just, it's just all right here. You know, it's just all voyeurism and living through other people and living vicariously through somebody's own internet and all that. God didn't call you to do that. It's you personally right here, face to face with the Lord, and then whatever he would put you in. The Lord would put you in the pit of vipers, of evil people. He might put you in a pit, you know, and put you in amongst all Christians. Whatever the Lord would call you to do, you need to be a willing vessel. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, to offer your body as a living sacrifice. That's a reasonable sacrifice, to offer ourselves to the Lord. To praise him, to give praises, offer sacrifices of praise unto him. You know, I went to this place, this Christian bookstore one time, and there was this effeminate guy. He was a Presbyterian preacher, and he owned this place. It's a Christian bookstore. Now it's only online, but I went to the store, and he was effeminate, and he didn't know that I could discern that and pick it up, and he was trying to talk to me and ask me to stay because I told him, you know, I was a pastor and all that. I could tell his real motive. He was effeminate. We started talking about, you know, I told him the church I was going to school through, an Assemblies of God church. He said, you know, I visited there one time, and I felt like, and you know, he just had an effeminate voice. They were just pressuring me that I felt like if I didn't raise my hands, well, they're just holier than me because they raise their hands when they praise the Lord. You know, and I just told him, you know, because I'm like that, brothers and sisters. People that met me, I'm like that. I'm not preaching to people when I meet them. I'm listening to them. I'm discerning them. I'm seeing how I can minister to them and help them. I'm being quiet. And that shocks lots of the people that I meet. I'm very quiet because I'm trying to hear from the Lord what he wants me to tell you and, you know, in your situation, how I can minister to you or not, as the Lord would lead me. So I have to be quiet to hear from the Lord. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I was being quiet, listening to this guy. But then, you know, when he said that, I said, well, you know what? The Bible says, Paul said, that I would have all men everywhere lifting holy hands to praise God. We're told to do that in the Word of God, to praise God. Now, lots of you can't even get past raising your hands. You're just so, it's really not a matter of trying to be, oh, I like solemn worship. I feel like I just need to be, you know, that God likes it when we're just solemn and, you know, and what is it, what do they say? They say stuff like solemn and how do they justify themselves? Let me think of these words. They say like, you know, it's being respectful to God and, you know, being reverential. That's it, reverential worship and all this. But the reality is they're only thinking about themselves and they're only thinking about how they might look bad or look like a fool. But Paul said, you know, I count it all as loss. I'll be a fool for Christ. I'll be a fool for Christ for your sake. The Bible also says God endures the foolishness of preaching that some might be saved. So that's why all these people, I'll tell you, brothers and sisters, the root reason why these people don't want to speak in tongues and they try to run it down and the move of the Holy Spirit, they try to run it down because they're ashamed and embarrassed that they might lose control, that they're not in, that's religion. The definition of religion is control. They don't want to lose control of the situation. They can't surrender to God. You know, and so maybe they're in their flesh, you know, as Jesus said, you know, God said they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. You know, Jesus quoted that from the Old Testament. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. You know, so when they get up there and sing all to Jesus, I surrender all. They're not surrendering all. They're saying, you know, God, this is my heart and I'll surrender this piece, but I can't surrender this piece. I can surrender this, but I can't surrender that because I might look like a fool. I might lose everything. I might lose my job. I might lose my friends. I might lose my house. house. I might lose my wife. You know, my wife is my God, or my job is my God, or money is my God, or pleasing people is my God, like Joel Osteen, you know, to please people. And all these other things that people run into and fro trying to get. And brothers and sisters, you have nobody on this earth that you ever need to please if you don't please Jesus first. You must be a Jesus pleaser, a Jesus follower. And then, secondarily to that, how can I serve people in honor to God? But my mission is not to serve people. That's humanism. That's humanism, brothers and sisters. That's the world. God didn't call us to, you know, it's all about serving people and all that. We serve the Lord, and out of His good pleasure, and to bring glory to His name, and to do His will, and to be conformed to the image of Christ. The Lord will use me to tell other people about Him. Not my means on this earth is not to win people to the Lord. My means, my purpose on earth is to bring glory to the Lord, to bring glory to God, to do His will, that His will be done in me as it is in heaven. And through that process, He would use me to do His will, which is He wishes none to perish but all to come to repentance. That He comes, you know, to get the reward of His suffering. You know, and that's the lost. Jesus came to seek and save the lost. And He uses us to seek and save the lost. But that's not my mission. My mission is to do what Jesus wants me to do. To follow Jesus. To do His will. To be conformed to His image. To bring every vain imagination into conformity to the Word of God. Not my own will, but His will be done. Even as Jesus in the midnight in the garden of good and evil, in the garden of Gethsemane, each one of us. If you want to follow Jesus, if you want to be used by God, if you want the anointing, you know, there's lots of people say, you know, there's many more, you know, it's got anointing. I'm not the only one, but people say, you know, Brother Patrick, you know, you've got an anointing. I would be used by God. Well, that's what it's all about. It's surrendering to the Lord and saying, Lord, Thy will be done. Not my will, not my agenda. Your will and Your agenda be done. And now let the Lord deal with people, not me. If the Lord would use me, I'm talking about, you know, the enemies of the cross, the enemies of the anointing, those Holy Spirit blasphemers, I give it to the Lord. Lord, it's up to you. Lord, the Lord is my judge. He's my only judge. He's my salvation. He's the one that'll say, enter into my rest, my good and faithful servant, or depart from me, I never knew you. There'll be no pope there, no potentate, no trolls, no demons, no devils. Nobody's going to be there to be the judge over me. It's going to be the Lord. And the question is, does He know you? Are you? He says, enter into my rest, my good and faithful servant, or depart from me, I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. Just like Matthew chapter 7, He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord. So saying Lord to Jesus is the world, or the, you know, these old dead denominations, their definition of being Christian is calling Jesus Christ Lord. So it's not non-believers in that standard of hyper grace. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord. The lost people that are not saying the sinner's prayer, not calling them Lord. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. And they will say, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out devils in your name? Didn't we do many mighty works in your name? And he'll say, depart from me, I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. Brothers and sisters, submit yourself under the hand of God right today, right now. Say, Lord, here I am, use me. And I'm talking about two different things here. I'm talking about salvation, and then I'm talking about being used to do God's will, to finish the race that God called you to do. I would say 90% of the people that I talk to do not run the race that God called them to. Everything out of their mouth is about themselves. You know, I bet I've had a dozen people that said they want to come to the Philippines, not because I want to do God's will, but it'll be my spiritual growth and my spiritual journey that I'm going to go to the Philippines and explore the possibility of working with orphans and all this kind of stuff. It's not about you, and it's not about your spiritual journey. It's about Jesus and His kingdom and His will. You don't need to know anything. If you're a servant, you don't need to know all that stuff of what the master's doing. You know, the master is the one who knows it. And then when he chooses, he can trust you, just like Abraham with Eleazar. When the master can trust you and give you more authority and more power and more anointing and all those favor and blessings and all that, he will. But all these people, 90% of the people making videos on YouTube are trying to grab power and authority that God didn't give them. And that's where these wannabes are going wrong. Brothers and sisters, you have to humble yourself. It starts out on your knees, seeking the Lord Jesus Christ. Knock and it'll be open to you. Seek and ye shall find. Ask and it'll be given you. Who do you ask? The Lord. And all you denominational people, you know, all these pastors who try to control people, they're your covering. They're, you know, you need to be their armor bearer and all that, because Aaron, you know, like Joshua was Moses' armor bearer and all that. There are cases when God did that. Elisha to Elijah. There are cases like that in the Bible, some. But you need to be an armor bearer to the Lord. You need to be a servant to the Lord Jesus Christ first, not to any man, not to any denomination, not to anybody, to Lord over you. The Lord is the one to assign people over people and authority in the ministry and all that stuff. Not all these denominations declaring. That's how we got all these false denominations and all these preachers who aren't even preaching the gospel. Because a man ordained another man into some authority that didn't come from God. It was a man-made authority. You know, oh, you've got your master's degree in a liberal theology seminary like Harvard Seminary that doesn't even believe in the Bible or in God. Therefore, Dominus, Ominous. You're a preacher in the Methodist Church. You're a preacher in all of these denominations, Presbyterians. You're a Catholic priest. You're all this because some man said you are. But God is the one. Just like Paul, God is the one who called him. Not anybody else. Not even the apostles called him. The Lord himself called him. And the Lord called each of the apostles, follow me. And the Lord called you to be saved. And the Lord will call you and anoint you to be what he wants you to be. And that authority comes alone from Jesus. What I'm trying to say is, again, to repeat, get with Jesus. Get with Jesus. Don't get with man. Get with Jesus. You alone get with Jesus. You need some face time with Jesus. The Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. Worship him. Read your Bible. Study. Praise him. Read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 after Jesus, Paul, under the Holy Spirit of the Lord, tells us about the rapture. Then he goes to things that you need to do to get prepared for the rapture. You know, pray without ceasing. All those things he tells us. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Go read that. Brothers and sisters, I got to go. I've been going on and on. I got more videos to make. God bless you. Be prepared to pass. You know, this is what the Lord told me about is passing under the shepherd's rod. You know, to be accepted, to be used by God at that next level. That's a whole nother video. But that's what the Lord's been speaking to me about today. You know, it's the time that he's examining his flock to promote people and all that kind of stuff. I never made a video about anything like that. It's just what the Lord's been sharing with me. But you know, you got to have yourself in your relationship with the Lord to be promoted to that next level. That's what I'm trying to say. Just to break it down in simplest terms. You know, you want to be promoted in the Lord, be used by the Lord. The sad part is a lot of you guys, you know, I was just talking about those people who, you know, who want to grab authority that's not theirs. You know, maybe that's better than people that are hiding from the Lord not doing nothing. I mean, and it's probably 90% of the people are doing that. So, you know, forgive me for probably being too hard on those who are trying to grab power and run with it in authority and do something that God didn't really call them to. Because it says in Jeremiah, it's, you know, it's easier to control a, you know, a wild mule. You know, God talks about man like being a wild mule. It's better to, you know, to try to steer a wild mule than one that won't move, you know, a stubborn mule that won't budge. So 90% of the people are stubborn mules that won't budge. 10% are mules that are running wild. And then the Lord, you know, says he can try to steer you. You know, it's easier to steer a moving car than a parked car. So most of you are parked cars, you know, and you're not going anywhere. And the Lord is, you know, kicking you into behind like an old mule. 90% of you. You need to get out there, get off of your blessed assurance, and get up. Stop clowning and stop living in a fantasy land and voyeurism and the internet virtual reality. Get out there and do something for the Lord.